Thank you. Thank you. Hello, everyone, and welcome to a very special episode of The Dish. I'm your host, Nathaniel Rosenberg, and if you're wondering what makes this a very special episode, it's because I get to share it with you. Every episode is special when I spend it with you. Welcome to The Dish. On October 3rd, Lindsay Lohan almost lost half her finger during a boating accident, and what day was it? October 3rd. If you didn't catch that Mean Girls reference, well, I will personally victimize you in my burn book. The incident was the second most horrifying vehicle-related injury Lohan has suffered. The first, of course, was Herbie Fully Loaded. On last Sunday's episode of Keeping Up with the Kardashians, I mean the 2016 presidential debate, we saw Trump and Clinton battle it out, providing enough material to have for SNL to have the highest rating since Tina Fey saw Russia from her house. Lines were crossed, daggers were thrown, and they didn't even shake hands. Most importantly, Ken Bone found his slightly creepy way into all our hearts. The only thing scarier than the state of American politics is the creepy clown epidemic plaguing college campuses. What seemed like a harmless but fun, creepy prank has now turned into a terrifying phenomenon. Coulrophobia, also known as the fear of clowns, has skyrocketed, whether in the dorm, the quad, the library, no one's safe. A wise warning to all our theater students, they are not one of you. If you see one, run. On the run right now as well are Kim Kardashian's robbers. On October 3rd, the same day as the Lohan incident, five masked men broke into Kim's Paris apartment. They tied her up and stole $10 million worth of jewelry, including her $4 million engagement ring. These Parisian bandits are suspected to be in connection with the Pink Panther Group, a cult-like robber group known for its precise stealth robberies dating back to the 1980s. If Inspector Clouseau can't find her ring, then no one can. And that's my pitch for the reboot. Wow, with all this talk of killer clowns, gory accidents, and Donald Trump, you'd think this was our Halloween episode. Anyway, we're gonna take a short break.
Getting ready to host Good Morning Emerson, of course.
Good Morning Emerson? What's that?
It's the best morning show ever that's on Tuesday and Thursday at 9 a.m.
Wow, how can I work on this?
Yeah, let's get going. Red leather, yellow leather, red leather.
Welcome back to The Dish. Do you like movies? Of course you do. Here to talk about movies is our film correspondent, Augie Vandeveer. Augie, take it away.
Thanks, Nathaniel. Jordan Peele of sketch comedy duo Key & Peele recently released a trailer for his upcoming film, Get Out. The film centers around a white woman who brings her black boyfriend home to meet her family. At first, the preview seemed to be a joke, playing a little bit too much to the human side of Peele's past. But as the plot went on, the whole concept was nothing less than terrifying. Who knew you could combine social commentary with horror? Oh, right, literally everybody. But what Peele does is combine a real-life horror, racism, with a fantasy horror, a gaggle of hypnotizing murderers, to make the scariest plot ever. The movie is set to premiere early 2017. If you're a fan of Jackie O, then get ready for the disappointment of a lifetime. A trailer for the upcoming film Jackie was released, showing Natalie Portman as the famous woman. Sure, Portman is short and dignified, like Jackie was, but the problem is all you see is Natalie Portman, not Jackie Kennedy. If you're going to do a biopic, do it right, with an actress that looks exactly like the woman, rather than a big star. The movie is set to premiere on December 2nd. Though good luck sitting through the entire movie without having to remind yourself at least twice that you're watching a movie about Jackie O, not Natalie Portman. Have you ever seen a movie and thought, too soon? Well, then join the hundreds of Boston residents who are outraged by the Mark Wahlberg's upcoming film, Patriots Day. In the movie about the Boston bombings, Wahlberg plays a police sergeant who helps track down the bombers. The film is set to be released in the summer of 2017. And hundreds of people who can only hope that the plot will remain fairly sensitive and true to the actual events. Speaking of Boston celebrities, Ben Affleck recently announced that he's the working title of his upcoming Batman film, The Batman. That's it, just The Batman. While some online are ridiculing the title, we should think positively. He must be working so hard on this movie that he had no time to think of a good title. Now, on to the reviews. Miss Peregrine's Home for Peculiar Children on paper seems like a strange film, but if you break it down, you can see the real human heart in it. So to begin, a bird-slash-woman creates pockets of never-ending loops of time so that superpowered children aren't eaten by Samuel L. Jackson in colored contacts. See? Simple. All right, so the actual plot is this. Jacob Portman finds his grandpa with his eyeballs plucked out and decides to investigate instead of curling up in a ball forever like a normal person. He heads to Wales to explore the boarding house his father told him stories about as a kid. Stories like, I knew a kid full of bees. He was an odd one. He gets there and hops in the never-ending time loop that the bird woman created. Her name is Miss Peregrine. She's spooky and is a tad obsessive about clock management. Go figure, seeing as every night a plane bombs the house, burning the whole thing to the ground, unless she plays dance music and twists her watch back a day. The kids are great. There are these two twins that you just know are going to go off, but for now are dressed up as mimes. There's the everything I touch lights on fire girl, the plant controlling girl, the love interest would fly away if I don't wear these lead platform shoes girl, and of course, entire body filled with bees boy. Personal favorites include the boy with a projector for a head that mostly shows his fashion ideas, and the boy who can put plastic hearts in anything and puppeteer them. If this all sounds strange, that's because it is. And once you buy in, you can really enjoy it. Case in point, Sam L. Jackson. He enjoys every one of his scenes because he knows exactly who he is. A spooky eyeball eater monster king. Yeah, eyeball eater. The main villain's plan is eat everyone's eyeballs. There's an eyeball buffet scene. I have no idea why children were brought to this movie. What you should be getting from this review is that this movie is far better than it should have been. Eyeballs, time loops, nonsense, whales. But what should have been a far too out there Burton jumble of weird turned into a really fun Halloween-y flick. And I'm not just saying that because there was a cool old guy character named Augie in it. No, that would be unprofessional. I'm giving this movie two thumbs filled with bees up. That's all for movies this week. I'm going to go look for hidden Illuminati imagery in the Scooby-Doo movies. Back to you, Nathaniel.
Thanks, Augie. You'll always be the cool old guy character in my heart. Anyway, in other news, I'm here with TV correspondent Danny Barbati and music correspondent Maddie Crichton. Selena Gomez is in rehab for anxiety, depression, and panic attacks, and this story is oh too familiar for many other child stars and Disney stars and Dish stars. We're going to discuss this frequent occurrence right now. Danny, Maddie, what do you think about Selena Gomez going to rehab?
I think it's sad because for a while it seemed like her big thing was like she's dating Bieber and that's the thing she's doing wrong. And it's like now Selena Gomez, she's already got her check, like the Disney star that did a bad thing, but now she has, you know, she's going following the route of so many ladies before her and the rehab, and it's probably because, you know, her relationship at such a young age was so, you know, a big media circus for so many years. And
Bieber is certainly a toxic person, and I would love to blame him.
I'd put a little blame on Bieber too, because there's no way that he didn't help that.
I just think it's fun to blame him also.
Yeah, I know.
Why?
Not a good guy.
Let's just confirm, Dish confirmed it's Bieber's fault.
It's Bieber's fault. Bieber, yes, we know what you did, Justin Bieber.
Report that as fact.
As fact.
We're an EIV news show and we report, yes.
Yes.
The latest scoop.
Awesome.
So why do you think it's Disney stars specifically? Because if you think about other child stars like Dakota Fanning or other child, Daniel Radcliffe, yeah. they're all fine, but it's the Disney stars. Well, they're okay, they're I guess you that kind of disproves my point. Disney female stars that always have like horrible messed up lives. Like something about like appealing to young audiences when they're a kid is like more damaging than mainstream movies. You know what I mean?
Right, yeah. I mean, like, yeah, it's like the media circus you were talking about earlier. Like, you know, all these Disney stars, they're roped in. They also have a record deal as part of their contract. Mm-hmm. You know, they have to, like, go and do, like, the whole pop star thing, too.
That's true.
I mean, it's a lot of pressure, especially these, they get into the industry so young.
Yeah, Disney must have control over, like, all their lives, right? And then it's like, once Disney lets go, they're like, what do? I have no aim anymore.
Yeah, they have no idea what it's like to be a normal human being outside of a set. Mm-hmm. They don't know what real life is.
I also want to talk about my favorite, everyone's favorite, childhood tragedy, Amanda Bynes.
Mm. Yeah, not Disney, but
not
still
Disney.
Tragedy.
Tragedy, yeah. Yes. I heard that, Maddie, you were telling me before this, that she was incorrectly diagnosed for schizophrenia?
Yeah, at first people were like, yeah, it's because Amanda Bynes is schizophrenic, and then all of a sudden they were like, no, she's not schizophrenic, and then it was like she was falsely diagnosed with schizophrenia, which is a hard diagnosis to get even if you do have schizophrenia.
Yeah.
So, I mean, poor Amanda.
Did you guys, like, enjoy her horrible, like, manic tweets, or did you feel, like, guilty?
Oh, I felt sad. I felt sad watching her tweet like that because, I mean, it just didn't make any sense, and it wasn't even like, you know, Kanye will tweet and it won't make sense, but like, you know, it's coming from just somewhere else.
And like, he's good.
Yeah, he's fine.
Yeah.
But Amanda she's not, so it's sadder.
Yeah, yeah. I first was laughing at it, like, ironically retweeting them, and I'm like, oh, I'm so hip. And then she went to rehab and got diagnosed with all these mental illnesses, and I was like, oh, I'm making fun of a mentally ill person.
Yeah. That's a great feeling when you realize that.
Yeah, yeah.
Whoops.
But I think she's okay-ish now.
Yeah, I think she's getting better. And then same with Lindsay Lohan, who we talked about earlier. Mm-hmm. She had a lot, you know, wrong with her. She kind of went through the whole thing, but now she spends a lot of time. Her, like, Instagram bio is, I like helping children in need.
Yeah.
So, I mean, she doesn't really say which children or, like, how she helps the children or anything. But you know what? It's better than whatever she was doing before.
That, yeah.
It is the thought
I help
that
children,
counts.
Don't ask questions, yeah, but I do it.
She has, like, selfies with them on Instagram, and it's like, I think they need more than just meeting celebrities to get better from whatever, like, has, you know, challenged them in life. But you know what?
Yeah. It's a start.
It is a start. Yeah. It's a start for sure.
Wow. I'm more forgiving for Lohan because, like, she's a mess, but, like, only to herself.
Yeah,
she never,
that's
like,
true.
Is mean to anyone. Mm-hmm. And she seems to be trying to help, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I wonder where her twin is now.
Yeah.
You never hear about her.
You never hear about that one.
From Parent Trap.
Yeah, right after Parent Trap. She must have just slid back into the normal world.
Well, let's hope that.
I mean, she got out early, you know, before she had a chance to go off the deep end in the public eye.
Unless the real Lindsay Lohan is fine and
it's
twin
her twin
is going crazy and Lindsay Lohan's getting a bad rep for it.
You heard it here first.
Yeah.
Lindsay Lohan's twin is the real Lohan.
Confirmed.
And the real Lohan is living it up with Tupac somewhere. That is our correspondent. Give it up for Danny and Maddie, please. Or don't give it up for them.
We suck.
You don't have to only clap for me. I know I'm great. Now we're going to send it over to our theater correspondent, Abby Creighton. What's new in the theater world, Abby?
Thanks, Nathaniel. Tony Award winner Dreamboat and former Hamilton star Lin-Manuel Miranda hosted Saturday Night Live earlier this month. Miranda opened the show with an SL-themed and politically charged version of the Hamilton song My Shot. However, the highlight of this episode had to be the new sketch Crucible Cast Party, which is a love letter to theater kids everywhere. The sketch, which is also a song, parodies a group of high schoolers' cast party after their performance of The Crucible, in case the name of the sketch didn't make that obvious enough. Most importantly, though, it emulates the cringe-worthy awkwardness of a high school cast party far too well, complete with braces, horny teenagers, and helicopter parents. Every classic theater kid stereotype is captured beautifully in a sketch that any self-respecting theater junkie needs to watch. Playwright and popular Twitter personality Johnny Sun has written a new play titled Dead End. It began its run on October 6th and will continue until October 23rd, presented by Theater Lab in Toronto, Ontario. The play follows two survivors of a zombie apocalypse, an immensely dark comedy about survival. In addition to being known on Twitter as an alien by the name of @JomnySun, the real Johnny Sun holds degrees from both Yale and the University of Toronto. With over 180,000 Twitter followers, Sun is someone worth paying attention to. You may see his work taking center stage soon enough. In a live read of Good Will Hunting, John Krasinski was able to reunite many old members of the cast, specifically Ben Affleck and Matt Damon. Among these actors were Emily Blunt, Hamilton star Daveed Diggs, character actress Margot Martindale, and Keegan-Michael Key, among others. Typically, live read events have their actors revealed a few hours prior to the event, but Krasinski, as the director, took it upon himself to keep the cast of the read a secret so as to preserve the surprise element for the big name cast. Place it on nostalgia, the raw talent in the script, or the performance of the readers, the live read was met with positive reactions and a lot of media buzz. It's always a fun time to see actors reprise their beloved roles. Tina Fey has been dropping hints that the musical production of Mean Girls is near completion. Faye cited a few instances that still need to be worked out, such as where to end the first act. Not many details on the musical are known at the time. Faye joked that the show will premiere in 2027, or whenever Hamilton ends its run. It seems more likely that we'll see the release of this show sometime in the next 5 years, but as with many industries, things can always change. While we eagerly await more information on the musical, we are more than happy to keep watching the much-beloved movie on repeat until then. Joshua Harmon's new show Significant Other just closed its run at the Speakeasy Stage Company. This new comedy about the trials of love hits home in heartwarming ways, because there's nothing more relatable to an audience of straight women than a lonely gay man. Watching Greg Mario's character Jordan Berman fall in love, suffer heartbreak, and watch his friends get married truly resonated for every young adult in the theater. Knowing that's what I have to look forward to made me cry almost as much as the ending. Always the bridesman, never the groom, Jordan journeys from supportive to selfish when he attends each of his crazy friends' weddings. You can really see Jordan's humanity, which made him so compelling to watch. He was grounded, he was truthful, and he was willing to have his cast members rip out his heart and serve it to the audience. I felt I was on his journey, even though I could hardly relate at all. The set design was a little off-putting at first, but as soon as the lights came up, it came to life. A blank canvas, it took us from Jordan's apartment, the club, the office, the weddings, and even Grandma's house. The lighting remained truthful to the sets, which made the characters easy to follow. The lights helped the actors walk through walls and relive memories. It was certainly reassuring to watch someone else relive all their failed relationships too. Significant Other is hoping to make its way to Broadway, and if it does, I highly recommend. That's all we've got for theater news. I'm gonna go rewatch that Crucible Cast Party SNL skit. Back to you, Nathaniel.
Thanks, Abby. That skit was a hoot, wasn't it? I wish I was friends with Lin-Manuel Miranda in high school, or had friends in high school, or now. We'll be right back.
Wow, our debates are on fire.
Ah! Oh no, why did I say that? Oh no, I'm on fire still, it is so hot! Why have I done this? Oh no! I'm still on fire, but one speechless on the Emerson channel! It's really good and full of action!
Oh, hi. Well, welcome back to The Dish. Well, I've been angrily writing blog posts about the horrible ABC Muppet series. Music correspondent Maddie Crichton's been listening to all the latest jams. What's the music news, Maddie?
We've got plenty of music news this week. Nathaniel Niall Horan debuted his first single as a solo artist this past week. The song, titled This Town, is about an old relationship of Horan's. Simon Cowell, creator of One Direction, has spoken out saying that he feels betrayed since Niall chose to release the song with Capitol Records rather than his original label, Psycho. Really, Simon? You want to talk about loyalty? You literally had a baby with your best friend's girlfriend. Cowell claims that the single would have done better if it had been released with Psycho, but fans all over are praising the boy bander for his new sound. And while some stars are coming out with new sounds, others are deciding to take a break from the music business altogether. After a recent interview with Glamour magazine went awry, Demi Lovato has announced that she will be taking a break from music and the spotlight in 2017. This is crushing news, probably, to a handful of teenagers in New Jersey who were hoping that Demi and the Jonas Brothers were going to possibly reunite for a Camp Rock 3. Chance the Rapper, aka the most perfect human alive, recently had a new Kit Kat commercial air, complete with an adorable jingle and the rapper himself in a teddy bear costume. Chance, a self-made artist, has been becoming more and more popular to the point where he even has a Grammy consideration ad in Billboard magazine. The ad, designed by Chance, has the caption, "Hey, why not me?" proving that Chance is what would happen if every Emerson College student suddenly became famous overnight. Kanye West recently canceled some of his tour dates due to the trauma that happened with his wife, Kim Kardashian, in Paris, France. During his concert in New York, West heard of what had happened to his wife and promptly told the audience that he had to leave because of a family emergency. Many concertgoers thought it was some kind of a joke, as West is known for doing more abstract things to get people's attention. Most people had assumed that Kim had lost her earrings in the ocean again or left North behind in a limo. Let's move on to a movie review, or a music review. Tween pop sensation Shawn Mendes released his new album, Illuminate, and you're probably thinking it's just a bunch of generic pop garbage, right? Some kind of wannabe Justin Bieber or something? Well, wrong. This album is actually good. Like, very, very, very good. You probably know Mendes best for his radio hits like Stitches and Treat You Better, but these songs do not represent what the whole album actually sounds like. It's much less catchy pop tracks and more sentimental singer-songwriter with a guitar. And trust me, I know I sound crazy talking critically about his music in a positive way. I am a grown woman who should be neither swayed nor charmed by Shawn Mendes. Someone who is 18 years old, but only by a couple of months, I would know I had to Google it. But I am, and I swear there's no way that I'm the only one. If you listen to this album, I swear you'll be wooed just as easily as I was. The lyrics on the album are actually meaningful, considering his audience is a bunch of constantly shrieking 15-year-old girls who'd be happy if he exclusively did covers of songs by The Wiggles. So I guess what I'm saying is give this album a chance, take those judgmental hipster glasses off, and let Shawn Mendes charm your socks off. That's it for music news and reviews tonight. I'm off to rethink my life because of that Shawn Mendes album. Back to you, Nathaniel.
Thanks, Maddie. I'm so excited about Shawn Mendes' new album. I mean, football. Yeah. Anyway, here to talk about TV is teen heartthrob Danny Barbati. Who wrote this? Take it away, Danny.
Thanks, Nathaniel. That was so kind of you, but you're the real heartthrob. Break out your best earth tone flannel and turn those baseball hats around. Luke's Diner is officially a thing. In honor of the upcoming Gilmore Girls Netflix revival, coffee shops around the country are dressing up as the show's most iconic eatery and handing out coffee in Gilmore Girl-themed cups for the day. No pressure, Cafe Nero. In other Netflix-related news, the streaming site recently released the first trailer for the upcoming series of Unfortunate Events reboot, and we all went back in time to geek out with our 13-year-old selves. The trailer features actor Patrick Warburton as he takes on the role of the series' fictional narrator, Lemony Snicket. This must be super exciting for all the fans out there who used to imagine Snicket sounding just like Kronk from The Emperor's New Groove. The series is set to come out in 2017. Are you one of the few people left on the planet who actually watch new Simpsons episodes live? Well, then get excited, because on October 16th, the show is going to air its annual Halloween special, which also happens to be their 600th episode. In honor of this milestone, Fox has partnered with Google to create a virtual reality experience for audiences watching at home. I think the only thing more unnecessary than watching a virtual reality Simpsons episode would be watching any Simpsons episode aired after 2005. There's no greater job in comedy than writing for Saturday Night Live during an election year. Unless, of course, you happen to be writing for Saturday Night Live during this election year. The long-running sketch comedy show premiered this Saturday and revealed Alec Baldwin to be their designated Donald Trump impersonator. Baldwin appeared alongside Kate McKinnon, playing Hillary Clinton, and together they absolutely killed it. It's nice to know that whatever stupid thing Trump says, we will always have Baldwin's impersonation of him saying it to look forward to. Stranger Things is officially getting a second season. This means more strangeness and more things, and apparently more characters. The show has already begun holding casting calls for three new major characters who are rumored to be called Max, Billy, and Roman. Hopefully these aren't three new super cute kids, because I don't think the world can take any more adorableness from this cast. The new season is expected to be coming to Netflix in 2017. The day has finally come. For the first time since they canceled Parks and Rec, NBC finally has a good sitcom. It's appropriately called The Good Place, and it's about life in the afterlife. The eponymous Good Place is basically heaven, but not tied to a specific religion, probably because they know their target audience is hipster agnostics. Kristen Bell stars as a woman who was accidentally sent to The Good Place due to a clerical error, and now must learn how to be a moral person to fit in. Ted Danson also nails it as the mysterious, endlessly upbeat designer of The Good Place. I know what you're thinking. This sounds inventive and brilliant and clever, so NBC will definitely cancel it, right? Well, not if we all watch it. Get your lazy butt onto Hulu right now and check this show out. Meditations on the Nature of Morality have never been so fun. By the way, it's created by Parks and Rec showrunner Michael Schur, which I hope is NBC's way of apologizing for Parks and Rec's cancellation. No hard feelings, NBC. Just for the love of God, don't cancel this show. Listen to me. Don't do it. If you cancel this gem of a sitcom, when you die, you'll be sent to the bad place. And you don't want to go there. That's the TV news. Back to you, Nathaniel.
Thanks, Danny, you handsome devil. That's all we got for you on this spooktacular episode of The Dish. Spooktacular. Now, we'll see you next time, and remember, stay safe from clowns, whether they're lurking around the streets of Boston or on stage debating against Hillary Clinton. Good night, everybody.